The climate change rally in New York City over the weekend drew in at least 400,000 activists, representing the growing awareness of the planet's climate crisis. Yet with such a strong symbol of dissent, one of the main organizing groups of the march, the Climate Group, receives funding from corporations like BP, Goldman Sachs, and Dow Chemical, just some of the companies at the heart of what these activists are protesting. Furthermore, while the protest was historic in numbers, award-winning author and Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Chris Hedges argues that such mobilizations are ultimately ineffective, adding that the main groups that sponsored the march in Manhattan are designed to, quote, neutralize resistance. Well, I was earlier joined by Hedges, and I first asked him why 400,000 people marching in the streets of Manhattan pose no threat to the status quo.
First of all, because there was no agenda. Second of all, because the establishment was part of the march. Groups like Environmental Defense Fund support fracking, get money from oil giants such as BP. They stayed within the perimeters that were given to them by the New York City police, as opposed to the march that I was part of Monday morning, Flood Wall Street, where without permit, 4,000 people walked out into the streets and shut down the streets on Wall Street, sat down in the middle of the road. Until we begin to engage in acts of mass civil disobedience, especially given the fact that the power elites, in particular the Democratic Party, embrace the rhetoric of climate change, we're not going to make much of a difference. Obama talks about climate change as real and as something that he intends to deal with within his administration, and yet we have seen Obama massively expand drilling on public lands, offshore drilling, fracking, of course, not only approving the southern leg of the Keystone XL pipeline, which is designed to bring down tar sands, shale oil from the Alberta tar fields, but now they've used old existing pipeline to essentially make it possible to ship that oil without building the proposed northern section of the pipeline. We're already seeing that oil be deposited in the Gulf. So the rhetoric of the Democratic establishment in particular doesn't match the reality. The reality is that the political system is captive to the fossil fuel industry, big coal, big oil, big gas. And unless we begin to disrupt the system, they will continue this form of ecocide, destroying what's left of the planet at this point for short-term profit.
And you advocate, of course, direct action, civil disobedience, disrupting the UN. It sounds amazing in theory, but considering the protest zones that exist and how any direct confrontation seems to be met with militarized force, how is that viable? How can we go in there and disrupt these meetings and say, hey, we need real change?
Numbers. I mean, I covered the revolutions in Eastern Europe. When you pull 500,000-600,000 people out into the street, and the police will not use lethal force to quell that demonstration. And remember, I was in East Germany. That Stasi state under Erich Honecker was about as ruthless and brutal as they come. And when 80,000 people started marching in Leipzig in the fall of September 1989, and Honecker sent down elite paratroopers to fire on the crowd, and they wouldn't do it. Honecker lasts another week in power. So I think that we have to begin to discredit the leadership through nonviolent acts of mass civil disobedience, because the system itself is seized up. It doesn't work. It is completely captive to corporate interests, and in particular, the fossil fuel industry. They write our laws. They own our courts. They control the systems of information, in particular the press. They use their money, in essence, to replace the vote. Their lobbyists write our legislation. And so the last mechanisms we have, if we are going to save ourselves as a species, is to disrupt the system. I'm not naive enough to tell you it's going to work, but appealing to the system is not going to work.
Right. And you've written, of course, politics is in the hands of the corporate state. Is anti-politics, real politics have gone underground, is what you're outlining now. How much does the notion of willful blindness play into the concept of political change?
Quite a bit, because in order, I think, to make a very cold and realistic assessment of systems or structures of power, it presents you with a very uncomfortable dilemma, and that is that because you can't appeal to the system to reform itself. That capacity has been taken from us. It requires a much more direct confrontation with systems of power. So you see, people who care, Bill McKibben is a good example, care and have sacrificed, Bill, for decades over climate change, and yet he will not go up against, certainly in a confrontational way, the Democratic Party. I don't want to in any way take away anything from Bill, who I respect immensely. I just have a different read on the power structure, and I don't think appealing to those segments of the power structure, and I think, the Obama administration has proven that point, is going to work.
Yeah, and you've talked about how our agency's been taken away. Capitulating to the system is obviously not working. Of course, this is exemplified in your recent lawsuit against Obama over the NDAA,
right,
in which the government can detain anyone indefinitely if they're believed to be an associated force with terrorism. The Supreme Court, of course, denied you the case, Chris. Aside from the sham of the two-party system, even if the system worked perfectly, do you see the judicial branch as a problematic entity in itself?
Well, all of the three branches of government have become captive to corporate power, and we have certainly seen that within the courts that have refused to stand up for our most fundamental constitutional rights. You brought up Section 1021 of the National Defense Authorization Act, in which I did sue the president over it. This permits the military, overturning over 150 years of domestic law, to seize American citizens who are deemed to be members of al-Taliban, the Taliban, al-Qaeda, or something called associated forces, a very nebulous term, and hold them indefinitely, strip them of due process, hold them indefinitely in military facilities, including in our black sites overseas. Now, this is a clear violation of constitutional rights, just as wholesale surveillance is a clear violation of our constitutional rights, and yet the courts will not intervene to protect those rights. And so when the lower court, the Southern District Court of New York, ruled in my favor and the Obama administration challenged it on an appeal, the Second Circuit, the appellate court right below the Supreme Court, rather than deal on the issue, which is kind of black and white in terms of constitutional rights to due process, they ruled that I didn't have standing. I didn't have a right to bring the case, which when we appeal that decision, the Supreme Court upheld. So that is just a small example of how the courts have been used to essentially eviscerate our constitutional rights by judicial fiat.
Yeah, it just seems like they've become almost emotional blackmail now. The politics has devolved to now where people are just voting for president so they might pick a Supreme Court justice that might not be fascist. I feel like that's where we are politically right now, Chris. I just think that there's a big problem, even if the Supreme Court justices weren't voting for the corporate state, to have kind of this unelected body there is just problematic. What do you think?
Well, we vote for personalities. We don't even vote on issues. There's a complete continuity on all of the major structural issues, whether it's the failure to curb Wall Street, the failure to enact serious environmental reforms, the failure to curb our lust for imperial war. I mean, in fact, Obama's assault on civil liberties have been more egregious than under the Bush administration, and that's because it's the same system. It's a corporate system of power. We've undergone what John Ralston Saul calls correctly a corporate coup d'etat in slow motion. And so, to elect a Democrat in the hopes that they will put a replacement on the Supreme Court who will not come out of the lunatic fringe of the Republican Party, well, the whole court system has collapsed, especially since 9/11, on the most basic civil liberties. The appellate court, the Second Circuit, is not the Supreme Court, and yet they wouldn't, in essence, take the case on what even the New York Times in an editorial called a clear constitutional issue or a clear violation of a constitutional issue when they were writing about my NDAA case. So, the court system has collapsed. The press has been consolidated into the hands of a half dozen corporations. We just saw it with the vote on Israel. I mean, here you have Israel carrying out egregious war crimes, attacking a population that has no army, no navy, no air force, no drones, no command and control, no mechanized units, calling it a war, dropping heavy ordnance all over densely populated areas. I mean, I was a war correspondent for 20 years. That's kind of a textbook example of a war crime. And yet 100 senators in a kind of Stalinist-like plebiscite or wind-up dolls for AIPAC all vote that Israel has a right to defend itself. I think that's a kind of window into how bankrupt our system has become. They are just, and that was a vote for campaign contributions for the Israeli lobby, which has a lot of money, and it's a kind of internal collapse. We have the facade of a democratic state, but we no longer have a functioning democracy.
Right. The Israel vote was, I guess it was shocking to see even people like Elizabeth Warren kind of give carte blanche to Israel. But then again, when you're signed up for the Democratic Party, you're kind of signing up for that whole MO, Chris. Why is Israel such a third rail aside from this stronghold that AIPAC has over the political system? And why do we never hear about Israel's policy on ISIS and Syria?
Money. I mean, Bernie Sanders, who's not a Democrat, voted with the other 99 senators to, in essence, cheerlead Israel's bombing of hospitals, homes, schools, apartment blocks, children playing soccer on a beach. And that's because the whole system has just been bought off. Our political system is a form of legalized bribery. And that's how it works. And if you can't get that huge infusion of cash, you don't stay in power. Or if you defy corporate interests, these very powerful forces will step in, and now, courtesy of the Supreme Court, they can do so not only in terms of unlimited spending, but they can do so anonymously. They will destroy you. And so, yes, across what's left of the political spectrum, which I would argue is very narrow at this point, you don't deviate. You don't deviate from the establishment policy. I mean, even Bernie Sanders, who is not a Democrat, has supported the attacks against ISIS, has supported the wars in the Middle East. And remember, I spent 7 years in the Middle East. I was the Middle East bureau chief for the New York Times. The fundamental problem in the Middle East is that we occupy the Middle East, and they don't want to be occupied. And 13 years of killing and maiming, and we beheaded far more people with drones than ISIS has ever begun to behead, creates these kind of radical, enraged entities, such as ISIS, and that will not go away until we leave. Violence has created the problem, indiscriminate violence on the part of American imperialism, now spreading out far beyond Iraq and Afghanistan, and of course today into Syria. And it's not worked. It's not worked. And it isn't going to work. Nothing's going to work until we stop occupying that region. And in fact, we are only going to further inflame, further radicalize, further enrage a population that does not want us there. And yet that is not part of the debate. It's not part of the equation. Within the kind of corporate-controlled media, the question is, do we put boots on the ground? Do we send actual soldiers in to carry out intervention, or do we just bomb them? That seems to be the parameters of the debate. And as someone who spent as long as I did in the region, and I'm an Arabic speaker, much of my life in places like Iraq, this is just absurd. It is to ignore the reality of what we've done, to ignore the cultural factors that are there, and to be kind of willfully blind to the consequences of our own misguided intervention and these preemptive wars, which, of course, are under international law illegal.
Right. I mean, looking at the empire to fix the problem by bombing when it's been caused by the empire bombing, it's the cycle of lunacy, really. I mean, and talking about the corporate media and especially these beheading videos, Chris, I feel like they're acting as the PR arm of ISIS. They're using these videos to galvanize support for bombing the group. Meanwhile, the U.S. has this amazing coalition of the willing joining its recent bombing campaign, including Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, a state that just beheaded 19 people. I'm speechless at the hypocrisy, but I want to get your opinion on it.
Well, of course. I mean, I think last month Saudi Arabia beheaded 30 people. And they were beheaded for things like sorcery, petty theft. So, we don't anymore have any sense of what's happening within the region itself. It's all become kind of cartoonish. These images, and, they are horrifying, of course, and criminal on the part of ISIS in terms of the beheading. That just, it gets sort of thrown at you repeatedly. A very complex situation, which we have largely unraveled. We've destroyed Iraq, of course, as a unified country. The fact that we are now, after 13 years, it tacitly allied with both Iran, Hezbollah, which is Shiite, acting as Hafez, as Bashar Assad's air force. I mean, you know, it's completely upended. We're actually working militarily on behalf of the very people that Dick Cheney and George Bush went into the Middle East to destroy. It just shows you the kind of chaos that, you know, blind military force has created within the region. But we don't deal in nuance. We don't deal in ambiguity. The coverage has deteriorated immensely. Most of the major newspapers no longer have correspondents there. They don't even make an effort. And the airwaves, it's right, it's all sensational garbage. And it's kind of frightening when you marry that kind of willful ignorance, even childlike ignorance about what's happening in the Middle East, with the capacity to deliver, you know, in tremendous amounts of industrial violence. It's a terrifying combination.
Yeah, I like that you said it was childlike, because that's how I feel like we're treated when it comes to the corporate media. Even within Israel, right. I feel like people are given a more fair representation with 972 Mag and Haaretz. But let's talk about the end goal in Syria, because, I mean, you heard Dick Cheney in 1992 saying, of course, pieces of Iraq are going to fly off if we go in and uproot Saddam. Why is it that it seems like, you know, A, they didn't know what was going to happen, and B, why are we going into Syria now? We know that they wanted to bomb them last year. What is the real end goal here, considering that this is completely unauthorized? There's humanitarian crises all over the regions of the world. Right. What's really happening there?
They don't have an end goal. They don't understand what they're doing. They don't understand the consequences of what they're doing. And so they react instinctively by using force, which they have the capacity to do. If they actually had a rational end goal, they wouldn't be doing this. You know, they bomb, and then things deteriorate, and things get worse. We replace Al-Qaeda with, you know, ISIS. If they get rid of ISIS, they'll replace it with something else. Very similar, by the way, to the way the Israelis have reacted to the Palestinians, where they've that constant use of force and inability to give the Palestinians what, under international law, they should have, which is their own capacity to have a sovereignty within their own state, has, you know, created further and further or harsher and harsher resistance movements that, I mean, that's just what happens. That's kind of normal. And, you know, the cauldron, the kind of witch's brew that we are unleashing, the idea that you're going to find moderate Syrian rebels, I mean, it's just laughable. There are all sorts of competing interests on the ground. There are tribal interests. There are Kurds. Let's not forget that we have Hezbollah fighting on behalf of Bashar al-Assad within Syria itself. And so, you know, in a kind of bizarre way, we are not only aiding the forces of Assad, but we're aiding Hezbollah itself by bombing ISIS, which has been fighting Hezbollah. I mean, it's kind of nuts.
I mean, I'm sorry to laugh, but it is so insane. You can't even make this up, but I don't even know what to say. I mean, let's just wrap this up here. Will the entire world need to become one giant sacrifice zone before people wake up to accepting that revolt is the only meaningful way to change, Chris?
Well, that's what they're doing. And, you know, every climate change report that comes out is even more horrifying than the last, the latest being that the biosphere can no longer absorb carbon emissions and CO2. I mean, and yet, the power elites, which of course are completely hostage to the fossil fuel industry, you know, the rational segment of the power elite will speak about climate change and do nothing. The irrational segment, the lunatic fringe of the Republican Party, you know, has just gone insane and will pretend climate change doesn't exist. But meanwhile, nobody is doing anything. And if we are going to leave this planet in any kind of a habitable form for our children and our grandchildren, we are going to have to begin to make massive sacrifices now to carry out massive acts of civil disobedience, because if we trust within the system, it'll kill us.
I couldn't agree with you more. Thank you so much for your incredible insight. As always, Chris Hedges, really appreciate you coming on.
Thank you.
The climate change rally in New York City over the weekend drew in at least 400,000 activists, representing the growing awareness of the planet's climate crisis. Yet with such a strong symbol of dissent, one of the main organizing groups of the march, the Climate Group, receives funding from corporations like BP, Goldman Sachs, and Dow Chemical, just some of the companies at the heart of what these activists are protesting. Furthermore, while the protest was historic in numbers, award-winning author and Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Chris Hedges argues that such mobilizations are ultimately ineffective, adding that the main groups that sponsored the march in Manhattan are designed to, quote, neutralize resistance. Well, I was earlier joined by Hedges, and I first asked him why 400,000 people marching in the streets of Manhattan pose no threat to the status quo.
First of all, because there was no agenda. Second of all, because the establishment was part of the march. Groups like Environmental Defense Fund support fracking, get money from oil giants such as BP. They stayed within the perimeters that were given to them by the New York City police, as opposed to the march that I was part of Monday morning, Flood Wall Street, where without permit, 4,000 people walked out into the streets and shut down the streets on Wall Street, sat down in the middle of the road. Until we begin to engage in acts of mass civil disobedience, especially given the fact that the power elites, in particular the Democratic Party, embrace the rhetoric of climate change, we're not going to make much of a difference. Obama talks about climate change as real and as something that he intends to deal with within his administration, and yet we have seen Obama massively expand drilling on public lands, offshore drilling, fracking, of course, not only approving the southern leg of the Keystone XL pipeline, which is designed to bring down tar sands, shale oil from the Alberta tar fields, but now they've used old existing pipeline to essentially make it possible to ship that oil without building the proposed northern section of the pipeline. We're already seeing that oil be deposited in the Gulf. So the rhetoric of the Democratic establishment in particular doesn't match the reality. The reality is that the political system is captive to the fossil fuel industry, big coal, big oil, big gas. And unless we begin to disrupt the system, they will continue this form of ecocide, destroying what's left of the planet at this point for short-term profit.
And you advocate, of course, direct action, civil disobedience, disrupting the UN. It sounds amazing in theory, but considering the protest zones that exist and how any direct confrontation seems to be met with militarized force, how is that viable? How can we go in there and disrupt these meetings and say, hey, we need real change?
Numbers. I mean, I covered the revolutions in Eastern Europe. When you pull 500,000-600,000 people out into the street, and the police will not use lethal force to quell that demonstration. And remember, I was in East Germany. That Stasi state under Erich Honecker was about as ruthless and brutal as they come. And when 80,000 people started marching in Leipzig in the fall of September 1989, and Honecker sent down elite paratroopers to fire on the crowd, they wouldn't do it. Honecker lasted another week in power. So I think that we have to begin to discredit the leadership through nonviolent acts of mass civil disobedience, because the system itself is seized up. It doesn't work. It is completely captive to corporate interests, and in particular, the fossil fuel industry. They write our laws. They own our courts. They control the systems of information, in particular the press. They use their money, in essence, to replace the vote. Their lobbyists write our legislation. And so the last mechanisms we have, if we are going to save ourselves as a species, is to disrupt the system. I'm not naive enough to tell you it's going to work. Mm-hmm. But appealing to the system is not going to work.
Right. And you've written, of course, politics is in the hands of the corporate state. Is anti-politics, real politics have gone underground, is what you're outlining now. How much does the notion of willful blindness play into the concept of political change?
Quite a bit, because in order, I think, to make a very cold and realistic assessment of systems or structures of power, it presents you with a very uncomfortable dilemma, and that is that because you can't appeal to the system to reform itself, that capacity has been taken from us, requires a much more direct confrontation with systems of power. So you see, people who care, Bill McKibben is a good example, care and have sacrificed, Bill, for decades over climate change, and yet he will not go up against certainly in a confrontational way, the Democratic Party. And, you know, I don't want to in any way take away anything from Bill, who I respect immensely. I just have a different read on the power structure. And I don't think appealing to those segments of the power structure, and I think, you know, the Obama administration has proven that point, is going to work.
Yeah, and you've talked about how our agency has been taken away. Capitulating to the system is obviously not working. Of course, this is exemplified in your recent lawsuit against Obama over the NDAA,
right,
in which the government can detain anyone indefinitely if they're believed to be an associated force with terrorism. The Supreme Court, of course, denied you the case, Chris. Aside from the sham of the two-party system, even if the system worked perfectly, do you see the judicial branch as a problematic entity in itself?
Well, all of the three branches of government have become captive to corporate power, and we have certainly seen that within the courts that have refused to stand up for our most fundamental constitutional rights. You brought up Section 1021 of the National Defense Authorization Act, in which I did sue the president over it. This permits the military, overturning over 150 years of domestic law, to seize American citizens who are deemed to be members of the Taliban, Al-Qaeda, or something called associated forces, a very nebulous term, and hold them indefinitely, strip them of due process, hold them indefinitely in military facilities, including in our black sites overseas. Now, you know, this is a clear violation of constitutional right, just as wholesale surveillance is a clear violation of our constitutional rights, and yet the courts will not intervene to protect those rights. And so when the lower court, the Southern District Court of New York, ruled in my favor and the Obama administration challenged it on an appeal, the Second Circuit, the appellate court right below the Supreme Court, rather than deal on the issue, which is kind of black and white in terms of constitutional rights to due process, they ruled that I didn't have standing. I didn't have a right to bring the case, which when we appealed that decision, the Supreme Court upheld. So that is just a small example of how the courts have been used to essentially eviscerate our constitutional rights by judicial fiat.
Yeah, it just seems like it's become almost emotional blackmail now. The politics has devolved to now where people are just voting for president so they might pick a Supreme Court justice that might not be fascist. I feel like that's where we are politically right now, Chris. I just think that there's a big problem, even if the Supreme Court justices weren't voting for the corporate state, to have kind of this unelected body there is just problematic. What do you think?
Well, I mean, we vote for personalities. We don't even vote on issues. There's a complete continuity on all of the major structural issues, whether it's the failure to curb Wall Street, the failure to enact serious environmental reforms, the failure to curb our lust for imperial war. I mean, in fact, Obama's assault on civil liberties have been more egregious than under the Bush administration, and that's because it's the same system. It's a corporate system of power. We've undergone what John Ralston Saul calls correctly a corporate coup d'etat in slow motion. And so, to elect a Democrat in the hopes that they will put a replacement on the Supreme Court who will not come out of the lunatic fringe of the Republican Party, well, the whole court system has collapsed, especially since 9/11 on the most basic civil liberties. The appellate court, the Second Circuit, is not the Supreme Court, and yet they wouldn't, in essence, take the case on what even the New York Times in an editorial called a clear constitutional issue or a clear violation of a constitutional issue when they were writing about my NDAA case. So, the court system has collapsed. The press has been consolidated into the hands of a half dozen corporations. We just saw it with the vote on Israel. I mean, here you have Israel carrying out egregious war crimes, attacking a population that has no army, no navy, no air force, no drones, no command and control, no mechanized units, calling it a war, dropping heavy ordnance all over densely populated areas. I mean, I was a war correspondent for 20 years. That's kind of a textbook example of a war crime. And yet 100 senators in a kind of Stalinist-like plebiscite or wind-up dolls for AIPAC all vote that Israel has a right to defend itself. I think that's a kind of window into how bankrupt our system has become. They are just, and that was a vote for campaign contributions for the Israeli lobby, which has a lot of money, and it's a kind of internal collapse. We have the facade of a democratic state, but we no longer have a functioning democracy.
Right. The Israel vote was, I guess it was shocking to see even people like Elizabeth Warren kind of give carte blanche to Israel. But then again, when you're signed up for the Democratic Party, you're kind of signing up for that whole MO, Chris. Why is Israel such a third rail aside from this stronghold that AIPAC has of the political system? And why do we never hear about Israel's policy on ISIS and Syria?
Money. I mean, Bernie Sanders, who's not a Democrat, voted with the other 99 senators to in essence, cheerlead Israel's bombing of hospitals, homes, schools, apartment blocks, children playing soccer on a beach. And that's because the whole system has just been bought off. Our political system is a form of legalized bribery. And that's how it works. And if you can't get that huge infusion of cash, you don't stay in power. Or if you defy corporate interests, these very powerful forces will step in, and now, courtesy of the Supreme Court, they can do so not only in terms of unlimited spending, but they can do so anonymously. They will destroy you. And so, yes, across what's left of the political spectrum, which I would argue is very narrow at this point, you don't deviate. You don't deviate from the establishment policy. I mean, even Bernie Sanders, who is not a Democrat, has supported the attacks against ISIS, has supported the wars in the Middle East. And remember, I spent 7 years in the Middle East. I was the Middle East bureau chief for the New York Times. The fundamental problem in the Middle East is that we occupy the Middle East, and they don't want to be occupied. And 13 years of killing and maiming, and we beheaded far more people with drones than ISIS has ever begun to behead, creates these kind of radical, enraged entities, such as ISIS, and that will not go away until we leave. Violence has created the problem, indiscriminate violence on the part of American imperialism, now spreading out far beyond Iraq and Afghanistan, and of course today into Syria. And it's not worked. It's not worked. And it isn't going to work. Nothing's going to work until we stop occupying that region. And in fact, we are only going to further inflame, further radicalize, further enrage a population that does not want us there. And yet that is not part of the debate. It's not part of the equation. Within the kind of corporate-controlled media, the question is, do we put boots on the ground? Do we send actual soldiers in to carry out intervention, or do we just bomb them? That seems to be the parameters of the debate. And as someone who spent as long as I did in the region, and I'm an Arabic speaker, much of my life in places like Iraq, this is just absurd. It is to ignore the reality of what we've done, to ignore the cultural factors that are there, and to be kind of willfully blind to the consequences of our own misguided intervention and these preemptive wars, which, of course, are under international law illegal.
Right. I mean, looking at the empire to fix the problem by bombing when it's been caused by the empire bombing, it's the cycle of lunacy, really. I mean, and talking about the corporate media and especially these beheading videos, Chris, I feel like they're acting as the PR arm of ISIS. They're using these videos to galvanize support for bombing the group. Meanwhile, the U.S. has this amazing coalition of the willing joining its recent bombing campaign, including Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, a state that just beheaded 19 people. I'm speechless right at the hypocrisy, but I want to get your opinion on it.
Well, of course. I mean, I think last month Saudi Arabia beheaded 30 people, and they were beheaded for things like sorcery, petty theft. We don't anymore have any sense of what's happening within the region itself. It's all become kind of cartoonish. These images, and they are horrifying, of course, and criminal on the part of ISIS in terms of the beheading. That just, it gets sort of thrown at you repeatedly, and a very complex situation which we have largely unraveled. We've destroyed Iraq, of course, as a unified country. The fact that we are now, after 13 years, it tacitly allied with both Iran, Hezbollah, which is Shiite, acting as Hafez, as Bashar Assad's air force. I mean, it's completely upended. We're actually working militarily on behalf of the very people that Dick Cheney and George Bush went into the Middle East to destroy. It just shows you the kind of chaos that blind military force has created within the region. But we don't deal in nuance. We don't deal in ambiguity. The coverage has deteriorated immensely. Most of the major newspapers no longer have correspondents there. They don't even make an effort. And the airwaves, it's all sensational garbage. And it's kind of frightening when you marry that kind of willful ignorance, even childlike ignorance about what's happening in the Middle East, with the capacity to deliver, in tremendous amounts of industrial violence. It's a terrifying combination.
Yeah, I like that you said it was childlike, because that's how I feel like we're treated when it comes to the corporate media. Even within Israel, right. I feel like people are given a more fair representation with 972 Mag and Haaretz. But let's talk about the end goal in Syria, because, I mean, you heard Dick Cheney in 1992 saying, of course, pieces of Iraq are going to fly off if we go in and uproot Saddam. Why is it that it seems like, A, they didn't know what was going to happen, and B, why are we going into Syria now? We know that they wanted to bomb them last year. What is the real end goal here, considering that this is completely unauthorized? There's humanitarian crises all over the regions of the world. Right. What's really happening there?
They don't have an end goal. They don't understand what they're doing. They don't understand the consequences of what they're doing. And so they react instinctively by using force, which they have the capacity to do. If they actually had a rational end goal, they wouldn't be doing this. They bomb, and then things deteriorate, and things get worse. We replace Al-Qaeda with, ISIS. If they get rid of ISIS, they'll replace it with something else. Very similar, by the way, to the way the Israelis have reacted to the Palestinians, where they've that constant use of force and inability to give the Palestinians what, under international law, they should have, which is their own capacity to have a sovereignty within their own state, has,
The climate change rally in New York City over the weekend drew in at least 400,000 activists, representing the growing awareness of the planet's climate crisis. Yet with such a strong symbol of dissent, one of the main organizing groups of the march, the Climate Group, receives funding from corporations like BP, Goldman Sachs, and Dow Chemical, just some of the companies at the heart of what these activists are protesting. Furthermore, while the protest was historic in numbers, award-winning author and Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Chris Hedges argues that such mobilizations are ultimately ineffective, adding that the main groups that sponsored the march in Manhattan are designed to, quote, neutralize resistance. Well, I was earlier joined by Hedges, and I first asked him why 400,000 people marching in the streets of Manhattan pose no threat to the status quo.
First of all, because there was no agenda. Second of all, because the establishment was part of the march. Groups like Environmental Defense Fund support fracking, get money from oil giants such as BP. They stayed within the perimeters that were given to them by the New York City police, as opposed to the march that I was part of Monday morning, Flood Wall Street, where without permit, 4,000 people walked out into the streets and shut down the streets on Wall Street. Sat down in the middle of the road. Until we begin to engage in acts of mass civil disobedience, especially given the fact that the power elites, in particular the Democratic Party, embrace the rhetoric of climate change, we're not going to make much of a difference. Obama talks about climate change as real and as something that he intends to deal with within his administration. And yet we have seen Obama massively expand drilling on public lands, offshore drilling, the fracking, of course, not only approving the southern leg of the Keystone XL pipeline, which is designed to bring down tar sands, shale oil from the Alberta tar fields, but now they've used old existing pipeline to essentially make it possible to ship that oil without building the proposed northern section of the pipeline. We're already seeing that oil be deposited in the Gulf. So the rhetoric of the Democratic establishment in particular doesn't match the reality. The reality is that the political system is captive to the fossil fuel industry, big coal, big oil, big gas. And unless we begin to disrupt the system, they will continue this form of ecocide, destroying what's left of the planet at this point for short-term profit.
And you advocate, of course, direct action, civil disobedience, disrupting the UN. It sounds amazing in theory, but considering the protest zones that exist and how any direct confrontation seems to be met with militarized force, how is that viable? How can we go in there and disrupt these meetings and say, hey, we need real change?
Numbers. I mean, I covered the revolutions in Eastern Europe. When you pull 500,000-600,000 people out into the street, and the police will not use lethal force to quell that demonstration. And remember, I was in East Germany. That Stasi state under Erich Honecker was about as ruthless and brutal as they come. And when 80,000 people started marching in Leipzig in the fall of September 1989, and Honecker sent down elite paratroopers to fire on the crowd, they wouldn't do it. Honecker lasted another week in power. So I think that we have to begin to discredit the leadership through nonviolent acts of mass civil disobedience, because the system itself is seized up. It doesn't work. It is completely captive to corporate interests, and in particular, the fossil fuel industry. They write our laws. They own our courts. They control the systems of information, in particular the press. They use their money, in essence, to replace the vote. Their lobbyists write our legislation. And so the last mechanisms we have, if we are going to save ourselves as a species, is to disrupt the system. I'm not naive enough to tell you it's going to work, but appealing to the system is not going to work.
Right. And you've written, of course, politics is in the hands of the corporate state. Is anti-politics, real politics have gone underground, is what you're outlining now. How much does the notion of willful blindness play into the concept of political change?
Quite a bit, because in order, I think, to make a very cold and realistic assessment of systems or structures of power, it presents you with a very uncomfortable dilemma. And that is that because you can't appeal to the system to reform itself, that capacity has been taken from us, requires a much more direct confrontation with systems of power. So you see, people who care, Bill McKibben is a good example, care and have sacrificed, Bill, for decades over climate change, and yet he will not go up against, certainly in a confrontational way, the Democratic Party. I don't want to in any way take away anything from Bill, who I respect immensely. I just have a different read on the power structure, and I don't think appealing to those segments of the power structure, and I think, the Obama administration has proven that point, is going to work.
Yeah, and you've talked about how our agency has been taken away. Capitulating to the system is obviously not working. Of course, this is exemplified in your recent lawsuit against Obama over the NDAA,
right,
in which the government can detain anyone indefinitely if they're believed to be an associated force with terrorism. The Supreme Court, of course, denied you hear the case, Chris. Aside from the sham of the two-party system, even if the system worked perfectly, do you see the judicial branch as a problematic entity in itself?
Well, all of the three branches of government have become captive to corporate power, and we have certainly seen that within the courts that have refused to stand up for our most fundamental constitutional rights. You brought up Section 1021 of the National Defense Authorization Act, in which I did sue the president over it. This permits the military, overturning over 150 years of domestic law, to seize American citizens who are deemed to be members of al-Taliban, the Taliban, al-Qaeda, or something called associated forces, a very nebulous term, and hold them indefinitely, strip them of due process, hold them indefinitely in military facilities, including in our black sites overseas. Now, this is...